She has talent, charisma, and a legion of fans whose devotion is legendary. Reba McEntire has been dazzling music lovers with performances overflowing with energy, emotion, and foot-stomping music, as you are about to find out. Right now, Reba is tuning up her guitar and vocal cords in 1 hour. She'll be live here on A&E, taking your calls on Live by Request. Reba McEntire has sold 40 million albums and earned 30 gold records. Her life has followed a path that is almost mandatory for a country star. Tough childhood, tougher marriage, heartbreak, and divorce. But she then eclipsed even Loretta, Tammy, and the others, climbing to the top of the charts and the pinnacle of country music.
Reba McEntire is more than just a passing fancy. The former barrel racing cowgirl became country music's top grossing female entertainer of all time. Her spectacular one-woman shows are a combination of a Broadway musical and Ringling Brothers Circus.
She's got a lot of class and style. She had it all in one great Reba McEntire package.
She's got a God-given talent. I've never seen anybody with that much energy.
She can make you cry, she can make you smile. And Reba is one of the finest singer actors I know.
The high wire performer has juggled singing, acting, and motherhood. She has won countless awards and accolades. She has also experienced overwhelming loss.
She grieved a lot. She still grieves today. It was a great loss for her.
Reba had the strength and faith to overcome her darkest hour. Today, she is one of country music's reigning divas, the queen of show queens.
Reba McEntire!
The singer's journey to stardom grew from her hardworking Oklahoma stock. She was born Reba Nell McEntire on March 28, 1955. She came from a long line of rodeo champions. Her grandpap, John McEntire, was a world champion steer roper in 1934. Her father, Clark, was a world champion steer roper of the late 1950s. Reba herself was said to have as much energy as a bronking cowboy by the time she learned to crawl.
Reba was hard to contain when she was little. She had boundless energy. She was just always into something.
I got to calling her Foxy. She is, you know, real bright red-headed, and she'd like a little red fox. She was just always into something.
Reba was the third of four children, Allison Paik, her older sister and brother, and Susie, her younger sister. All the McEntire kids helped their parents run their humble cattle ranch in Chalky, Oklahoma. The work was hard. The hours were grueling. The rambunctious redhead learned how to ride a horse and work cattle when she was 6 years old. Reba spent her childhood traveling the rodeo circuit with her family. Her mother, Jackie, who was a teacher and a one-time aspiring singer, taught her children how to harmonize together during those long, dusty drives across the country. Reba inherited her mother's gift for music.
I think her first formal appearance was when she's in the first grade, and she sang Away in the Manger at the Christmas program in school. That was her introduction.
She knew from a very, very early age that she wanted to sing. And she took voice lessons early on. She took piano lessons. She knew that she had a goal. Reba's always a ham. We used to stand in front of Mama's mirror with hairbrushes and pantomime songs off the Motorola.
Reba pursued her artistic interests. She also followed another love, the rodeo. Her older siblings, Paik and Alice, both competed in rodeo events. By age 11, Reba entered her first barrel racing contest.
Reba always had a very competitive edge to her, just like we all did. You know, she liked to run barrels, and she ran barrels on my old calf horse, which One trip we were on to Lubbock in Texas, in San Angelo, Texas. She did real good. Took this horse and beat some of the top girls.
Reba was reared to work hard and play hard. In 1969, she entered high school. The popular adolescent excelled in academics, played guard on the girls' basketball team, and was a member of the 4-H club. At the same time, she was still responsible for doing chores on her family's ranch.
At the McEntire house, the girls were girls, but the girls were also boys. When I'd get home from school, I had two horses to ride, mine and Alice's, to keep them in shape, because Alice was in college. And I'd go in and I'd change into my jeans, and I'd put on my sweatshirt, and it was white. And the next day, I'd turn it around, so it would be white on this side. And the next day, I'd turn it inside out, and the next day, I'd turn it around. So I wore it 4 days, because, you know, I didn't want to have to wash clothes.
Reba was mostly towards being a tomboy. I mean, she can get out there and roughhouse with the best of them, but she can look very feminine. We weren't raised in a well-to-do family. Clothes weren't a big deal to us.
You know, Daddy always had cattle, and there was always something to do. We all down at the lots, and Daddy sent Reba to the house to cook us something. Well, Reba never could cook. She had red beans, she had green beans, she had pork and beans. She had like four kind of beans and no meat. Now, we never sat down at the table without any meat. I think Daddy might mention something a little later. Said, boy, Reba, it's a good thing you can sing because you can't cook.
The teen was destined not to spend the rest of her life in the kitchen. Her mother, who worked as a secretary at her high school, convinced the superintendent to let the students form a singing group called the Kiowa Cowboys High School Band. They performed a variety of country and rock tunes. Reba sang vocals with siblings Paik and Susie, and occasionally played the drums and guitar.
Played for football, pep rallies, we had country music concerts, country Christmas concerts, all kind of fundraisers. And we were just this band, and man, we were just like heroes of the school.
The Kiowa Cowboy High School Band became so popular that the group was offered paying gigs in honky-tonks and dance halls. Reba and her siblings even found a way to continue performing for pay during their summer break.
When Daddy would rodeo, people would stay in hotels, and they didn't have air conditioning and TVs in the rooms in those days, so everybody would congregate in the lobby and visit. And someone offered Paik some money to sing one day, and Reba said, well, he's going to get money for singing. I can do that. And so she sang also.
Reba, Paik, and her younger sister Susie sang for cowboys on the rodeo circuit. The trio became the Singing McEntires. In August of 1971, they were invited to Benson Recording Studio in Oklahoma City to record their first 45, The Ballad of John McEntire, a song their high school teacher wrote about their famous rodeo grandfather.
We loved the attention. Remember one place in particular, Mama was working the door because that's all we were playing for. They wasn't going to guarantee us any money for sure. So, boy, this crowd was really eating up everything we did that night. And so on the way home, we was commenting about it to Mama. And she said, that crowd was pretty energetic. I counted 14 fights during the night. And
cowboys and country music became Reba's life. In 1973, the aspiring singer graduated salutatorian of her high school class. She enrolled at Southeastern Oklahoma State University, majoring in elementary education and minoring in music. She dreamed of a singing career and still longed for a life in the rodeo. But her no-nonsense father discouraged her from pursuing the tough and often discouraging life of a barrel racer.
I hate to see somebody that's got a natural talent and then just want to run barrels, see, which she didn't have any talent running barrels that I could see, but she had a lot of talent to sing.
I really always wanted to sing. If I couldn't be a world champion barrel racer, I wanted to sing. Of course, I'd like to have done both, but I wasn't that good at riding. So the singing kept coming along and constantly improving.
Reba nurtured her singing. In 1974, during her sophomore year in college, Reba's father encouraged her to get a job at the National Finals Rodeo in Oklahoma City, instead of just going up to watch and have a good time.
Clark said, "Why do you want to go up there and just waste time for? Why don't you try to get a job if you're going up there?" She said, what'll I do? And he said, "Well, ask for a job to sing the national anthem." And I never will forget that.
Clark McEntire's persistence paid off. In December of 1974, Reba was invited to sing the national anthem at the National Finals Rodeo in Oklahoma City. Country music star Red Steagall, who was in the stands, was impressed with the 19-year-old's distinctive voice. Red offered Reba a shot at stardom. In March of 1975, Red Steagall invited Reba and her mother to Nashville, Tennessee, the country music capital. The novice vocalist was initially reluctant to audition as a soloist, but her mother encouraged her to pursue the dream that she wasn't able to. Reba took her mother's advice and recorded a demonstration tape. Red Steagall then pitched her tape to record producers on Nashville's infamous Music Row for 8 months. On November 11, 1975, Reba finally signed a deal with Polygram Mercury Records. The cowgirl was on the road to becoming a country singer. Reba McEntire, an unknown singer from Oklahoma, was trying to carve a place for herself in country music in the late 1970s. At the time, the biggest female acts were Loretta Lynn and Dolly Parton. The music scene in Nashville was competitive. The McEntire Trio thought Reba had the best shot at making it. As a result, the Singing McEntires formally disbanded in 1976. Paik and Susie went on to sing as a duet, while Reba concentrated on a solo career. In 1978, Three Sheets in the Wind, Reba's duet with Jackie Ward, went to number 20 on the country Billboard charts.
We had no idea that it was going to be this big. I mean, we were just ecstatic when she got her first single. You know, to be on the radio was a big thing for us, for Reba. And it still is. When I hear her on the radio, it's like, well, they're playing Reba.
Reba stayed in college while she struggled to get her music career off the ground. Her songs were drawing some radio airplay, but not enough to make a living. As a result, Reba finished earning her degree in elementary education.
So she's on this major label, but she was still living in Chalky, Oklahoma, a community of 18 people. And she was living in a house where the rent was $10 a month, and there was no running water.
The 21-year-old singer was not getting much attention in Nashville. But back in Oklahoma, she got the attention of rodeo star Charlie Battles. Brother Paik casually introduced Reba to Charlie, who was married with two children at the time. Reba was instantly intrigued by the world champion steer wrestler, who was 10 years her senior.
I always thought he was really good looking and rugged and reminded me a lot of Daddy. And so we saw each other at rodeos and fell in love. And then he got a divorce from his wife, and then we fell in love more.
Charlie eventually proposed to Reba, but her protective brother disapproved of his sister marrying his good friend. Reba thought Charlie was more than good enough. The couple got married on June 21st, 1976, in a Baptist church in Stringtown, Oklahoma. Paik didn't attend the wedding, but eventually warmed up to Charlie as his brother-in-law. Reba left her protective childhood surroundings and embarked on a new adventure. The newlyweds spent their honeymoon traveling the rodeo circuit and visiting radio stations to promote Reba's records. In 1977, the young recording artist released her first album, Reba McEntire. But female country vocalists, other than Dolly Parton and Loretta Lynn, were having a difficult time selling records and concert tickets.
Very strange thing about all forms of American music in the, up until recently, it was a man's game. And I guess that's because little girls bought the records for a while.
It was hard for her back then because she was a woman and because she was coming up, you know, in the ranks of country music. She had to prove herself, and she had to prove to them that she was going to be there for the longevity, not just for a little while.
Polygram Mercury Records promoted Reba as the wholesome Oklahoma girl who sang traditional country tunes. In 1978, she hit the road singing at dance halls, county fairs, and rodeos. The venues were small, but her voice was powerful.
She didn't have the stage presence then that she has now. She was shy. She would look at her feet, and people would be staring at the floor, wondering what was on the stage. But she had the voice. She had the pipes.
Reba was here to stay. On September 17th, 1977, she was invited to perform at the Grand Ole Opry in Nashville. The hall was home to country greats Johnny Cash, Hank Williams, and Loretta Lynn. The night was extra special for Reba when she met one of her longtime idols, Dolly Parton.
Oh, I guess 30 minutes before I was supposed to go on, they said, Reba, we're going to have to cut you back to one song. Dolly Parton has just pulled in backstage. And I said, are you serious? And they said, yeah, we know we're upset. I said, no, you mean Dolly Parton is here? Can I meet her?
Dolly Parton sensed that the curly redhead had what it took to make it big.
Well, Reba's very likable. She's a great person. You can tell her heart's as big as her hair used to be. And I just felt like that she had the warmth and the big-heartedness, in addition to all that talent, to really do something great.
Reba's powerhouse voice and fresh-faced looks were slowly getting noticed. In 1980, she recorded her first top 10 single, You Lift Me Up to Heaven. By 1982, she had released four albums, which demonstrated her competitive drive to succeed.
I think Reba has a sound in her voice that people relate to. There's a lot of emotion. There's a lot of depth. She has a wonderful range. She has great pitch. But I think people relate to it because they can believe it. You believe that she has lived every single song she sings. If she's talking about a heartache or a heartbreak, you just know that she's just suffered that thing.
Age and experience helped the once shy and reserved singer emerge from her shell. She became more confident on stage. She also wanted more control over her songs and her image. In 1984, Reba left Polygram Mercury and signed on with MCA Records, who gave her the freedom she was yearning for. The vocalist met with the top songwriters in Nashville and began choosing her own material that reflected her beliefs and interests. She also had a hand in planning her concerts. Reba's personal interest in her career paid off in a short period of time. In 1984, the same year she signed with MCA, she won the Female Vocalist of the Year at the Country Music Awards, an honor she would receive for the next 3 years. The former cowgirl said she was finally living her mother's dream. But Reba had no idea just how far the dream would take her. Reba McEntire worked hard at finding bigger and better ways to express herself musically. By the early 1980s, she was competing with a variety of successful female country artists, such as Barbara Mandrell, Crystal Gayle, and Emmylou Harris. Reba felt she needed a way to set herself apart.
When whoever's in New England's through with you, and Boston finds better things to do, you know it's not too late, 'cause you'll always have a place to come back to.
In 1986, the singer began producing music videos, which at the time were primarily being produced by rock groups and were considered radical to the traditional country music scene. But the progressive cowgirl felt it was a way to combine her two artistic interests, singing and acting.
I hear the winter time up north can last forever.
Music videos were very controversial in the early 80s, and I was really wanting to do one. It opened a lot of doors for me to be able to see on television me, my single, me acting a little bit, putting the song and the music and the face and the voice and the name all together in one package was the greatest publicity I could have thought of.
In the hallway, but before you leave again, there's just one thing you ought to know.
Music videos made Reba's music known to the world. In 1986, she won her first Grammy Award for Best Country Vocal Performance for her first music video, Whoever's in New England.
So she just happened to be one of those great women that really fit right in a wonderful pocket, and she held that spot very well.
On October 28, 1987, Reba made her debut at Carnegie Hall in New York City. She was riding high on her career, but her personal life had fallen apart. She and her husband, Charlie, had lived on a 214-acre cattle ranch near Stringtown, Oklahoma, since 1980. But Reba now wanted to spend more time touring rather than tending to their cattle.
What started happening was that I started growing up. And when I started growing up, I wasn't the little girl that he married. And I started to have a little few thoughts of my own and ideas of my own. And that didn't go over very well. And then I didn't like him having total control. And that was a problem. And it's just that lives grew apart.
I think he was just a little less inclined to go with her, and she wanted him to go with her, and so things kind of fell apart.
Reba divorced Charlie after being together for over 11 years. The singer put her failed marriage behind her and concentrated on her career. She moved from her home state of Oklahoma and took up residence in Nashville. By 1988, the self-proclaimed Okie transformed herself into a business-savvy artist. She created her own company, Starstruck Entertainment, where she co-produced her albums and created a song publishing firm.
Reba's a perfectionist. She wants things, and she wants them done right. She wants to do them well.
Reba the person is very much like Reba the professional. She has a temper, but only in the wake of slothfulness. She expects people to give 100% because she gives 110%.
The trailblazing artist evolved emotionally and physically. By the end of the 1980s, she branched out from conventional country performances. She incorporated choreography and flashy stage designs to her shows, which were still foreign to country music performances, except for Barbara Mandrell and the Mandrell sisters. Many country music critics complained that Reba's concerts had more smoke than songs.
One of the problems that country performer faces is that when they get polished or they give you a full performance, the dyed-in-the-wool people say, oh, she's sold out or he's sold out. That's very unfair. The thing I love about Reba's show, the very first time I ever saw it, was I said, she's going to give me more than just stand there and sing.
And you don't even know that's all I'm not saying.
shows, the videos, the productions, everything is competition. It was bigger and better. It was, let's see what we can do. We all figured out later it was basically to entertain me because I have the attention span of a 2-year-old. Babe, your bag is packed, so take it back.
Reba made big changes in her professional and personal life. In 1988, she hired her steel guitar player, Narvel Blackstock, to be her new manager. Narvel shared Reba's ideas on how to run a business. The two worked closely together. Reba's musical career flourished with Narvel as her manager and idea man. A year later, their business friendship turned into something more.
Narvel definitely fits her better as far as the music is concerned, because that's all they talk about. Eat, drink, and sleep, music.
The couple's professional and personal relationship soon became one. On June 3rd, 1989, Reba and Narvel got married during a private ceremony in the middle of Lake Tahoe in Northern California.
They really complement each other well. That's a marriage that is right, and it works, and it's really special.
The workaholic couple had to postpone their honeymoon. In 1989, the country star had ventured into another creative endeavor, acting. After her wedding ceremony, she was called back to the set of her first feature film, Tremors, a sci-fi comedy starring Kevin Bacon. Reba was cast as a quirky survivalist.
I thought, my Lord, if this is movie making, I don't want anything to do with it. This is the hardest work I've ever done. No control whatsoever. They tell you when to get up, and then they take you to this trailer, and they leave you, and then 10 hours later, they come back and say, okay, it's time for your one line. I said, this sucks. I hate this. I'm never going to do this again. And then you watch the movie. It's like, wow, well, that was good.
Wait a minute. So now I have to earn my way to San Francisco? You never said one word about contenders.
Oh, get a grip, Hawks. When's the last time you saw five women agree on something? Never. Because it's
Tremors was just the beginning of Reba's acting career. In 1991, her friend Kenny Rogers cast her as a tough-talking cowgirl in his television miniseries, The Gambler Returns.
But you're here now, and so's the money. What are you going to do about it?
Reba fell in love with acting. But her success in movies and on stage was overshadowed by a tragic accident that would forever change her life. Reba McEntire thought her life was complete. She married a man she deeply loved and was still passionate about performing. In 1989, her greatest hits album went platinum, but the singing sensation found something more meaningful than music. On February 23rd, 1990, Reba gave birth to her son, Shelby.
I said, Reba, with all that you have won and all the accomplishments you've made, you have not lived until you have a child. And when she had Shelby, that's one of the first things she says, now I know what you were talking about. He is the light of her life.
I think motherhood changed Reba a great deal. I always thought she was great anyway, but you know, I saw that immediately. But that had become her masterpiece.
Motherhood also provided Reba with another life experience to incorporate into her music. By 1991, she was at the height of her career. She embarked on another nationwide tour with her band, some of the most talented musicians and backup singers in the business. Gone were the days of traveling in trailers and vans. Reba and her band now jetted in comfort to concert dates. Flying afforded Reba and her band the ability to perform more concerts a year. But Reba had no idea at what price. On March 16th, 1991, Reba finished a performance in San Diego, California. She and her husband, Narvel, planned to fly out to their next gig in Fort Wayne, Indiana, the next morning. But her band decided to fly out that night to prepare for the concert. At approximately 1 a.m., most of Reba's band arrived at San Diego's Brown Field, a small airport near the seaside city. They boarded two jet airplanes, the Sabreliner and Hawker. At around 1:40 a.m., the two small planes took off on a clear night under calm winds. The flight seemed routine. The Sabreliner aircraft flew over Southern California's Otay Mountains toward the Midwest. But something went terribly wrong aboard the Hawker aircraft. 3 minutes after takeoff, the plane was still climbing altitude. When its left wing accidentally clipped a jagged mountain ridge, the aircraft cartwheeled, then exploded, killing 8 members of Reba's band as well as the 2 pilots.
We got a call about 2 o'clock in the morning that one of the planes had hit the side of the mountain. And the other plane had flown to Memphis and had stopped. And when the guys got out of the plane, they saw, you know, up on the hangars and stuff, it said Memphis, Tennessee. And they said, hey, what are we doing in Memphis? Aren't we supposed to be in Fort Wayne? And they said, well, guys, we're not going to Fort Wayne. And they said, why not? I said, well, the other plane crashed.
The Federal Aviation Administration later reported that the pilots couldn't see the mountainous peak because there were no lights to guide them. But the news was no consolation for Reba. The country queen proclaimed this was her darkest hour. Reba and Narvel returned to Nashville to prepare a memorial service for her 7 band members and tour manager, whose lives were cut short.
She was absolutely shattered, as anybody would be. I know myself, working with all the bands, band members that I have through the years, you get so attached to them. They're like brothers and sisters in your group.
Mike Allen, who booked that date for us, was there, who's my booking agent, and he said, well, we got to, Reba, when do you think you'd be able to go back on stage? And I looked at him and Narvel, and I said, what do you mean? Probably never.
Reba was unconsolable. She didn't know if she could ever return to the stage. She had canceled all future concert dates. However, she was scheduled to perform at the Oscars the following week.
And Waylon Jennings called me. He said, Reba, don't feel guilty. Don't let guilt eat you up. Now, I'm a firm believer of what happens is supposed to happen. God has a bigger plan than we do. But it didn't stop me from missing them and hurting. But I didn't feel guilty. I just missed them.
She grieved a lot. She still grieves today. It was a great loss for her. Me personally, as a sister, I didn't really realize that it was that hard on her.
Family, friends, and fans gave Reba the support she needed to carry on. On March 21st, just 9 days after the crash, she attended the Academy Awards, where she sang, I'm Checking Out of This Heartbreak Hotel, the Oscar-nominated song from the film Postcards from the Edge, starring Meryl Streep. But the evening was overshadowed by sadness.
I mean, to get to sing at the Oscars, but, you know, the only great thing I could say about the whole evening was that I got to sing a song for 7 of my band members and my tour manager and 2 pilots.
After the tragic plane crash, a lot of people said, Reba McEntire, what a heartless person. She's out there working again, doesn't she? Where's her mind? I said, you don't understand. At the heart of every good entertainer, they know the show must go on. It really doesn't have to, but we've got to. And she did what she had to do. For that, she should be complimented, not criticized.
The show went on for the country music queen. Reba eventually went back on tour with a new band and a new outlook on life.
I think probably the most moving and emotional one was the night that she performed. It was the first night back after the plane crash. It was unbelievable. Not only seeing her, but the reception of the people. And that was one that will always stand out.
Reba returned to the glittering spotlight. She had experienced overwhelming loss, but she was determined to triumph once again. Reba emerged from her darkest hour with unstoppable determination. Her beloved band members were gone, but she would always carry their memory with her to every concert, keeping their spirit alive through her music. And then I got me a Georgia mansion in an elegant New York town. By the mid-1990s, female country artists were under tough competition from the explosion of so-called male honk superstars like Garth Brooks, Clint Black, and Vince Gill.
I think one of the coolest things about her is she's never been intimidated by anyone.
Reba is into these huge productions and her shows and stuff. They're massive. She wanted people to always come and see something fresh and new.
Reba was one of the few female country entertainers who successfully competed for ticket sales with the men. She packed stadiums and concert halls with her one-woman marathon shows.
Reba McEntire!
Fans obsessed over Reba's hair and wardrobe as much as they did her music. The sophisticated performer hired famed costume designer Sandy Spica to personally design her gowns and costumes. A very revealing red sequin dress Reba wore to the 1993 Country Music Awards caused such a scandal that it made media headlines.
Sandy had designed this red dress for me, and she came in, and we were doing a fitting, and so I tried the dress on, and I said, well, Sandy, don't you think it needs a few more rhinestones? You know, it's kind of low. And she said, oh, yeah, I'll put a lot more on there. I said, okay, sure, yeah, it fits good. So the night of the CMA Awards show, the lighting in the dressing rooms weren't probably that good. So I put the dress on. I'm out on stage first, and I hear the audience go, I thought, I look so good. This is wonderful. I've never looked this good before. Unbeknownst to me, my mama and little sister Susie are sitting up in the audience.
I just looked over to mama and said, oh, mama, like that. And she says, oh, my Lord. I mean, it was pretty shocking.
I thought she looked all right, you know.
Well, I wasn't too pleased with it, but I wasn't going to comment on it. I told this girl in California I thought she had it on backwards, and it did look like it could have been cut out for the back slope, you know, but...
Reba's low-cut dress didn't turn away fans. She continued to dazzle audiences with her high-powered concerts. The performer challenged herself athletically on and off stage. In 1996, the 41-year-old learned how to ski. But no sooner had she taken up the sport when she suffered an accident on the slopes, which left her with a broken tibia bone in her knee. The entertainer worried she would be forced to return to the stage without the energetic acts that had become her trademark.
I was petrified. I didn't think they would come back to see me because I wasn't changing clothes and we didn't have the dancers and it wasn't razzle-dazzle. But I fell in love with the music all over again. And I found out that they did come to hear me sing, and they loved the music as much as I did. I'd just kind of forgotten it for a while.
The accident helped Reba reclaim her love of singing. By 1999, her knee had mended. She resumed her hectic workout on stage, sporting a new short haircut. But it was the music that touched her heart. She had spent time after her accident reflecting on her success. She has won countless awards, including 2 Grammys, 10 Academy of Country Music Awards, and 6 CMA Awards. But despite her accolades, she's never let go of her country roots.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
How you doing?
Just fine.
There you go.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming in.
Reba knows she's been given a rare gift. As a result, she feels responsible for giving back. Her company supports many philanthropic projects, including Texoma Medical Center, Reba Ranch House, and the Reba McEntire Center for Rehabilitation. She funds these charities through monies she receives from records, concerts, and a growing career in Hollywood, where she's appeared in 9 films.
She undergoes this metamorphosis from Reba McEntire, superstar, public figure, magnetic icon, to homebody.
The country diva spends her free time like many working women, enjoying moments with her family, traveling, and watching movies. But she feels her life's purpose is being on stage, bringing music and inspiration to her adoring fans. Reba's rise from cowgirl to country queen is a fairy tale come true. Her raw talent and family work ethic propelled her to superstardom. She is the top-grossing female country artist of all time.
She's a household word to the point of being an American fixture. Even people who might not like her music nonetheless know who she is.
I think she's a tremendous standard for all young artists to aspire to be like.
And being able to survive and through so many different phases and over such a long period of time in the music business, she's still going strong.
Right now, Reba McEntire is standing by, waiting to take your calls. Reba, Live by Request, hosted by my friend Mark McEwen, is coming up in a moment. For the past few months, she's been touring the country with her stage show called The Singer's Diary. It's part Broadway, part Nashville, and a showcase for her acting and singing. She's also been promoting early childhood reading through Reba's First Book Club, which provides new books to poor children across America. So stay right there. Reba, Live by Request, coming right up.